I haven't actually listened to these songs because I don't care. Let's talk about something else instead. Y'all know that you can, like, not talk about this kind of stuff? Not listen to it? There's so much music in the world, a lot of it made by good people. You don't have to seek out the stuff that awful people make. Like, yes, okay, there's no ethical consumption under capitalism, yada yada yada. That's mostly about, like, the basic needs of survival. You can't choose not to eat. You can choose not to listen to the baby. It's very easy, in fact. Like, I know a lot of people are getting sick of moralism, but, like, that's because it's being applied in places where it really doesn't need to be. I don't want to hear think pieces about whether or not Gayle's a bad person because of a song she wrote, or whether or not Billie Eilish is queerbaiting. I literally don't care. Morgan Wallen shouted the N-word, Kodak Black sexually assaulted a girl, Kanye supported the fascist president. These are the kind of things I'm mad about. The kind of things where a moralistic angle needs to be applied. I don't really care whether or not these are good or bad songs. It doesn't matter, because the well's already poisoned before I even hit play. Going forward, and this ties into my desire for curation in general, I'm just gonna not cover songs if I don't want to. Maybe it's because they were made by an awful person. Maybe they just don't give me anything to talk about whatsoever. Whatever it is, I'm not interested in engaging with art that gives me no reason to engage with it, or reason not to engage with it. I value my time too goddamn much for that. Anyways, let's get this episode started for real. This is Billboard Monthly. I could do this for hours and hours and hours. This is a cute little vibe. Muni Long coos and bells about the simple joys of love over a dreamy R&B instrumental. It's all very pleasant, but I can't help but feel that Muni Long doesn't seem to understand the concept of rhyming. The chorus on paper already looks pretty inane. She breathes life into it through her performance, sure, but the verses aren't really any better. Like, if you're gonna say the same thing twice, maybe at least change the rhyme. And no, this doesn't count. I'm going to ignore that you already used both showers and hours earlier in the verse, but reusing the same rhyme in such close proximity. Proximity? Really? And then this stanza would be perfectly fine, except you randomly interrupt the rhyme scheme and then pick it back up like we wouldn't notice you dropped it in the first place? Felt like giving up on it. There you go, solved your rhyme. To her credit, this is the only forced slant rhyme in the entire song, but half credit only since there's still one of them, Muni. I could go on for hours, but like, y'all get the point by now, right? I can sit and talk to you for hours. And okay, you could argue that's what gives us its charm, makes the whole thing feel off the cuff and improvised, and like, yeah, I guess, but it's still really distracting. The song doesn't really give me much to work with either. The instrumental is nice, but bare bones, with Muni's vocals being the only thing making it dynamic, and it just ends unceremoniously. Like I said, it's a cute little vibe, and not much else. Under the surface, I feel berserk as a tightrope walker in a three-ring circus. Oh boy, time to talk about Encanto, a movie I haven't seen. Probably won't see. I've said it before, I'll say it again, I'm not big on movies, like, at all. So we're just going to address this as a song and nothing else. And as a song, Wait, if I could shake. Well, it's kind of a weird genre pileup. It takes a Latin bass line and adds a lot of modern pop tones, with a piano break in the middle, and an R&B-esque chorus that reminds me a bit too much of LMI's Trip. And it's dramatic, sure, but it never feels cohesive. It has a lot of ideas, but they don't flow or connect together. It's almost like, and don't kill me for this, but it makes me think of AJR way more than I'd like. But okay, it's more the soundtrack for a movie scene. What's the story then? I'm the strong one. I'm not nervous. I'm as tough as the crust of the earth is. Well, pretty straightforward, actually. Jessica Darrow's character is that strong in body, fragile in mind archetype that's not uncommon, but she's compellingly written here, overworking herself to the point of mental exhaustion, but internalizing the notion that not being able to carry everyone else's burdens would make her weak, despite that being a feat that nobody is capable of. It's a mindset that's tough to break out of, especially when everyone around her is reinforcing it. So yeah, on that level it works. However, well, let's take a step back first. I know we weren't perfect, but Olivia Rodrigo, like Darrow, is an actor, a talent she uses to enhance the emotional drama of her music. She is still singing more than acting, but she's leveraging her strengths to really make that drama sound convincing. And here's where you'd expect me to say that Darrow is failing at that, right? But nah, she's a damn good actor too. Under the surface, I think about my purpose. Can I somehow preserve this? The big ugly sticking point is that, boy, does this ever sound like an actor singing. Halfway between singing and a dramatic reading, really, which I'm sure would kill in the context of, like, a Broadway musical. But in the song, it sounds awkward and overwrought. Like, she's really trying to squeeze every last drop of emotion out of every line. And as someone who loves melodrama, it's too much, even for me. I'd bet this song in the movie, with the visuals supporting it, absolutely rules. But between its haphazard nature and Zero's performance, it doesn't quite work as, you know, a song outside of that. It's solid enough, pretty catchy too, but it's not fully working for me either. Now I remember when you call me late at night. Man, this song makes me feel like I'm living in a time loop. It's January, a song is going viral from some random 18-year-old, and it's a breakup song about a relationship nobody really cared about. Where have I heard that one before? So, okay, you pretty much already know what this is about, so is this the next driver's license? No, nah, not even close. Introduced me to your family. Like, it's fine. The instrumental has a solid 6-8 rollock to it, and it's got some nice swell. Lauren Spencer Smith sounds kinda like Alessia Cara trying to sing with a Billie Eilish inflection, but she does well to sell the emotional core of the song. And even the writing is, well, nothing special, though it's less clumsy than Olivia's, and the details are there to sell her heartbreak. But it's just lacking the subtle things that made Driver's License so potent. When you said you loved me, well, you must have had your fingers crossed. Like, for one, its big wham line is just weak. Childish, even for a teenager. And there's no real unique flavor here. Driver's License framed itself all around the car motif. Those revving synths were all over the track. And it had a really unique structure that didn't follow the usual loud, soft dynamic Fingers Crossed does follow to a T. It's like if Olivia had tried to break out not with Driver's License, but with Traitor. You betrayed me. Her most unremarkably good song, enjoyable while I'm listening to it, has absolutely nothing that makes me want to return to it. And Fingers Crossed doesn't even sound as gorgeous as Traitor either, so it fails to live up to even that standard. Again, I like it well enough, it's fine, but I'd be shocked if Lauren Spencer Smith catches on in the same way Olivia did off the basis of this song. The spark just isn't there yet. Cut it out with the goddamn flashing lights in your videos. Jesus Christ, dude. Is that gonna be the aesthetic for the entire album cycle? Can we not? Anyways, Dawn FM already feels like it kinda came and went, huh? It was the big event album of January, but it already feels like most people have moved on, and yeah, I mean, I get why. It doesn't have the depth of replayability to it that After Hours did, and Sacrifice is a good case study for that. You through the toughest parts when you feel like it's the end. Like, the Weeknd basically spends the entire song here trying to find a good hook and none of them land. The verses, the pre-chorus, the chorus, none of them have strong hooks. The bridge is the closest he comes, but the song's basically over by that point, and the song just ends without really resolving anything. It feels weirdly limp and unfinished, which again is a problem a lot of the album has. And the content's not really revolutionary for him either. Basically, the entire bit is, I tried not to give in to my vices so I could stay with you, girl, but I failed. Oh well. And that's like, well, basically the same purpose Heartless served for the last album cycle. And despite never fully getting it, Heartless has the darkness and hedonism to it to back up that attitude that the airy, bouncy sound of Sacrifice just can't. Like, I'd struggle to call this a bad song, because it's not, it's solidly enjoyable, but it's not even as good as Take My Breath, a song I've always been disappointed by. It's certainly one of the more accessible tracks on the album, I get why it was the single, but it's too weak of a groove, too emotionally dry, and really just too lacking in standout elements for me. It's alright, but like, you're the After Hours guy, man. And now, the big one. Well, here we go. We don't talk about First things first, that butt at the end of the first chorus is comedy gold. They really do want to talk about Bruno, huh? Spending the entire song taking one anecdote and extrapolating from it to act like Bruno's reason for every bad thing that's ever happened to them. The second verse just being vague, oh, he's evil, yeah, rhetoric. By the third, Bruno actively trying to help and getting scorned and blamed for the problems he was trying to warn them about. It sure is handy to have a scapegoat you can shove any responsibility for your own failings onto, huh? Promised and someday be mine. Even the dissenting voice trying to vouch for Bruno gets lost amid the chaos, which, I get what the outro is going for, a bustling argument with everyone trying to make their cases all at once, but the mixing and panning is really unbalanced such that you get two voices coming through clearly and drowning out all the others. It feels both too busy and yet not busy enough. Compared to Surface Pressure, well, it's way catchier despite how short and sporadic its chorus is, and the genre pivots feel a lot smoother too. While it stays in its central lane for most of the song, the backing instrumental fits really well for the rap verse, and the one instrumental switch up to a string-driven, inspirational pop sound is intentionally jarring and out of place because, well, her story doesn't align with everyone else's either. It fits the narrative. I definitely see why this is the big hit from the movie, the first new number one of the year, but, well, I don't think it has the same magic that Let It Go had that is going to last in the same way, because it's a lot harder to divorce the song from the movie. It's better than Surface Pressure, but it is still a show tune first and foremost, and a pop song second. Is it weird to say that Justice era Justin Bieber might be his best era? Like, I haven't listened to any of his albums because lol lmao, but as far as the singles go, there's only one I don't care for. The rest range from solid to genuinely quite good, with this being the best one yet. There's a driving energy to the percussion, and the acoustic guitar and piano lend an organic element that gives it a very upbeat but grounded feel, selling an emotional arc of... I know you crossed the bridge that I can't follow. Well, I'm actually not sure. Like, is this about a breakup? About being physically distant from his wife? Is it literally about death? It's kind of vague, not helped by there being exactly 9 distinct lines in the entire song, but maybe it's about all of them. None of them? That vagueness does keep his emotional core feeling rather distant, even if Bieber's really trying to sell with one of his most heartfelt performances to date. At the very least, I'm on board with the bronze sentiment of celebrating the memory of something you can no longer have, because that's, well, kind of the way we need to treat our past to stay sane. Yeah, it sucks when you can't make more good memories of someone, but that doesn't mean the ones that happened weren't good while they lasted. I know I've said some harsh stuff about Bieber in the past, sure, but like, he's on the right track this past year. I'll give him credit for that. As we enter year 3 of the pandemic, it's about time we got a song that well and truly captures the zeitgeist of every teen and young adult who's had to live for the past 2 years of misery and, just as importantly, boredom. Of course this blew up on TikTok, why wouldn't it? All I do is sit around and wait for better days is the motto of an entire generation at this point. Though... Do you remember last night, cause I blacked out, in an all white dress with a back out. Apparently, it's actually Polo G's verse that's big on TikTok, which also makes sense. Who the hell's a naked? What's a May Muller? Polo G is the woman of clout here, and he rides this slick, new disco groove like it was second nature. Which, speaking of that groove, let's give a shout out to those hordes, baby! Like, hell yeah, this rules. Better Days feels like it nails the same mood Super Lonely faceplanted trying to capture, basically. Slick, catchy groove, a guest verse that doesn't suck, and that feeling of existential exhaustion that so many kids and, hell, let's be honest here, adults are feeling after these past few years. I'm betting this one's only gonna get better over time, especially when summer hits, and I can't wait to see where it takes us. And that's that for a rather exciting and diverse month. Pretty easy to find something to engage with if a song's willing to give you something to work with, eh? Everything I talked about here, I do enjoy to at least some extent, too, which is great. It's way more fun to like things, even acknowledging their imperfections and weaknesses. Hopefully 2022 keeps delivering on that front. Wherever it takes us, well, I guess I'll see y'all next month.